Hello, welcome to Enos Engineering. I'm Alan. This week we're looking at DRO scales and the readouts for the lathe. This is a two-axis scale from Banggood. We'll be looking at what you get in the kit for this, and also be looking at how to fit scales to the lathe. This is one of the scales. We'll be fitting one to the bed of the lathe and then one to the cross slide. So let's go to the workshop and see how we do it.
Well, today I've had some parcels arrive from Banggood. I'll show you what they are. First of all, we've got the instructions in English for the digital readouts. A power lead. Now, this power lead is not a UK type power lead. That socket's okay, but this socket is a non-UK. So I've found a lead I can use instead of this. This is a standard UK lead, the 3-pin plug on the one end and the same socket on the other end. You can get these for monitors or for kettles, or you could chop the plug off the end of the one supplied and fit a standard 3-pin. The display. This comes with a plastic cover which you can take off. It stops the dirt and oil from your hands getting on the keyboard. And on the back it has some cutouts for the cables to go through. So I'll take that off now so that the light doesn't reflect off the plastic. This one's a two axis, X and Y. You can get them with the third axis, which is there. Knowing what I know now, I would buy the readout with the three axis because it's only a few pounds more and you could use it on your milling machine or the lathe. The internal programming is the same. We'll turn it round. On the back, you have your on-off switch, the plug for your power supply, and the two sockets for the X and Y axes. If you're thinking of buying one, I'd go for the three axis. They're in identical cases and you can change the program to say whether it's fitting a lathe or a milling machine. You can swap the negative and positive, so if you're travelling towards your chuck and it's going negative, you can change that in the program. So if I just run through what we have X and Y readouts. We have a screen for information. It could also display what subdatum you're on or the answer to any calculations. You have a calculator, which is a standard calculator. It has sine, cosine, tangents, square root. You can convert from metric to imperial just by touching this button at any time without losing the position of the X and Y axes. It'll just swap over instantly from metric to imperial. You have an enter key, council key, and down the bottom here you have programs for drilling holes on pitch circles and the key to change from absolute to relative position on the readouts. And SDM is for subdatum. You can store up to 200 subdatums, and when the power is switched off it will remember those positions. These are the zero buttons for the scales, and if you press the Y or the X enter button you can put the size in. So if you're at the end of a bar on your lathe you can touch the tool on that, and then if you want to go in 10mm you just press the X or Y and enter the distance on the keyboard, and then that will put the 10mm position in the readout. And with the readout you also get a mounting bracket. I'll just get the parts out. The scales are glass scales. I was surprised that there were no instructions or documents at all with the scales. I would expect some guidance on to how to set the scale and what distance the sensor needs to be from the scale. but there was nothing at all. You also get in the kit a bag of screws, nuts, and some cable ties for fitting the scale. You get the bracket for fitting the reader to. It's the same bracket, whatever scale you buy. Scale comes with the cable already fitted. Let's move the display out the way so we can look at the scale. You can get other scales. I say this is a glass scale. By that, inside, what we mean with a glass scale, inside here is a piece of glass, and on the glass is marked or etched divisions. So as this reader travels along, it reads the divisions. You can get magnetic scales, which are very similar to the scale on a digital caliper. They are a lot smaller and probably be more suitable. This is a section of the material used to hold a magnetic scale. And all it is an extrusion. You can see it's smaller, nearly half the height. It's a bit wider than 19 millimeters, about 20. But this you get in a length, and you just cut the length to whatever you need. The magnetic tape goes in this groove here. And the magnetic tape is in a length as well. It's sticky back, so you just cut it to the length you need, and the head is smaller. And you might think, well, why didn't I go for that? And the reason is the magnetic scales, for some reason, are 4 or 5 times the cost of a glass scale. So I thought, well, I can have 2 or 3 of these easy for the price of one of these. Another thing you get with the scales are these aluminium covers. They're just an extrusion. See that? And you just screw that over the top. On the end, you have the plug, which fits to the readout box. That's held on with 2 screws. And the scale itself. Then the scale's held onto the machine with 2 screws, one through the side or through the end, on both ends. So you need to drill and tap 2 holes into your bed or your cross slide to hold the scale. And the reading head here, which is held on temporary with the cable ties, that fits to a bracket, which is supplied with the part. Here's the bracket, and that bolts onto your machine as well. So the first thing you need to do is measure the length of travel of your machine before you order the scale. Because when you get the scale, it'll be longer than the length of travel. This one's a 200mm scale, and it's 340mm in length. And that's because on the scale, the readout is in the middle where this little arrow is. And when it moves to the end, it's a good 1.5 inches in each end. To get the readout length that you need, the scale will therefore be longer. Let's say you've measured your machine and you want 175mm of travel. Looking at the scales, they come in 50mm ranges. So you could have 150, which would be too small, or the next size is 200, which it would fit. So when you purchase your scale, you'd ask for a 200, but it would actually come out another 140mm longer due to the reader width and the end fittings. I'll plug the readout into the back of the display. On the back of the display, you have your 2 inputs, or 3 if you bought the 3-axis one. So I'll plug the cable in there, and it has 2 screws to hold it in position. The mains voltage is 80 to 265 volts. At 50 to 60 hertz. I plug the mains power cable in at the bottom and switch on the power. It does a checks through its system, then displays the results. Now, I'm not going to go into detail at the moment on this because it gets a bit boring. All I'll say, you've got X, Y, and you might have Z if you buy the 3-axis one. This is an information box, that's just telling me that subdatum number 1 is here, You can zero X and Y any position. If I want to put 150 mil in X, press X, 1, 5, enter, and it will start at 150 millimeter. If you want to work in imperial, you just press this button, millimeter to inch, and that changes it instantly from millimeters to inch. It remembers both, so you can switch between millimeters to inch as many times as you like. It still remembers it. If you switch this off, it will remember the position and the subdatums that you've saved. With the subdatums here, you can feed in up to 200 different positions, which could be tool offsets. As this scale moves, you can see the digital reading moving. I think really there's too many decimal points there for inches. If you go into metric, you've got 3 decimal points. The bottom here, you've got some other features, but for a lathe, these are not used. They're used for milling machines, for hole positions, for putting pitch circles in.
We'll now look at how I fit this to the lathe.
This is the lathe at the moment. What I've done to get better access, I've taken the carriage off the top, the cross slide, compound slide. All I did to do that was undo 2 Allen screws that go in the front here and 2 that go under the back to hold the saddle on. I can take the saddle off, and I've taken the tailstock off to give me access to the back easier. It was either that or remove the lathe from the cabinet and put it on the workbench, which I didn't really want to do. There's a lot of work to do that. Just get yourself a piece of steel and drill a hole in the steel, which is the size, the tapping size for the screw. Now this steel will be the guide to make sure that when I'm drilling the bed, I'm square. The size of the screw is 5 millimeter, and this is a 4 millimeter drill. So that's one thing you'll need. And the other thing is a clamp to be able to clamp under the bed to clamp the piece of metal in position. Now what I've done before I took the saddle off, I moved the saddle fully down this end, and I've marked here the farthest it moves down, and then I moved the saddle fully down this end, and I've put another mark down this end where the saddle moves down. So I know that my scale has to be within those two marks. In other words, the reader on the scale has to travel at least between those two marks. So that gives me an idea of the positioning. Also, bear in mind that when the saddle's on, there's a clamp that goes underneath this part of the bed. So I can't come too high. I need to leave a good half inch between the radius here of the casting and the top of the scale. To still put the cover over once it's fitted. Now I've got the scale, and on the scale I've marked 70 millimeters in each end, and I've put a black mark, and that is the length that the scale will move. That's the 500 mil. The other bit on each end is the extra to allow you to bolt it down. That's my 500 mil mark. That mark needs to at least be where the red mark is, so at least I need to know that I can get there. You can see down here I've got a problem already. I have to move it slightly off so I'm not in this hole in the casting. I can just get in on the end of that red mark if I put it there. So what I think I'll do first is drill the hole in this end. Now I've clamped this block of steel with the hole in for the drill in the position I want the hole to be. And now it's just a matter of drilling the hole. About 10 mil, so that should be okay. Now I can take the clamp off and the steel.
And now I'm just tapping the hole. Okay, now using that as a location, I'll bolt the scale on and then mark the position of the second hole. Well, that's a scale fitted. This slider will slide along the scale. And I hope the cover will fit, which will go over there. Now I fitted the bracket on to the sensor, and I've used the four cap heads that come with the kit and the four washers. Well, I've added four spring washers just in case these come loose over time. So now I'm ready to finally fit the scale on the back. I'm making sure I've got this the way around I want, with the cable coming towards the headstock. I've made some aluminium spacers that go on the back of the scale just to bring it 3 millimeter off the casting, because I noticed the scale was trying to bend, which means that the casting's got either got a lump in it or is not perfectly flat. That's going to be a problem here, because underneath this I've got another piece of steel to go on. This end is minus 0.01, the other end minus 0.01. So I think that's the top of the scale level.
Well, that's it for this week. We'll carry on next week fitting the sensor and then start work on the cross slide. Hope that was useful. Hope you enjoyed it, and we'll see you next time on Enots Engineering.